directs the heart failure program at El Camino. And I wonder how many of you know there is actually a heart failure program here. You guys know that? They're thinking, heart failure. Now, why is that very important? Well, Jeff is a real world expert in heart failure management, and he has a team of nurses who are experts, and every heart failure patient who comes into the hospital, he and his team take a look at and make sure they are really getting the best care possible. The reason he's giving a talk today is because there recently came out some recommendations in blood pressure management, which is very important in the development of heart failure. And I certainly know, given the number of questions and discussions I've had in my office, we live in a very curious, informed community here. They all wanted to know our opinion on that. So what I'd like you to do, if you could very briefly here, just sort of summarize the recommendations and put them into perspective for us.
Thank you, Brett. Welcome, everybody. It's good to be here. Seems like every year the Heart Forum gets bigger and bigger. So my two roles in this area are, one, I'm medical director of heart failure here, and I'm also the team cardiologist for the San Jose Earthquake soccer team. And you'd be surprised, actually a lot of elite athletes even have hypertension, so it's a universal problem. So just to quickly outline what I'm going to talk about, I'm going to briefly touch upon the risk factors for hypertension. I'm going to briefly mention the old guidelines that we used to use up until this year. And I'll get into the classification scheme for the ACC/AHA guidelines that came out in November 2017. Mainly going to focus on non-medication interventions. The previous panel touched upon some of the really important things that we can do to prevent and also treat hypertension. And then I'll wrap it up by summarizing the treatment guidelines. So the main problem, hypertension affects 1 billion people in the world. It is the leading risk factor for death and disability. It's also the leading risk factor for stroke, heart attacks, and heart failure. It's estimated that with this new classification scheme, about 46% of the American population is going to be defined as having hypertension. And having just a systolic blood pressure above 130 could potentially double your risk of these events. Some risk factors that we should cover about hypertension. So modifiable risk factors, there's a risk factor of smoking, of course, diabetes, high cholesterol, things that we can control, obesity, physical inactivity, and unhealthy diet. Less modifiable risk factors, kidney disease, family history, male gender, older age, sleep apnea sometimes, stress, sometimes not that modifiable, but it's certainly a risk factor, and also poor access to healthcare. Just to briefly touch upon the old guidelines, there are the JNCA guidelines that came out in 2014. The thing I liked about these guidelines was that it was very simple. Now, the cutoffs have changed since then, but the way they broke it down was basically if you had a blood pressure greater than or equal to 140 over 90, that we should treat that. If you're older than age 60, it was more lenient, and the blood pressure cutoff was 150 over 90. But if you had kidney disease or diabetes, regardless of your age, you needed treatment. For the new guidelines, the ACC/AHA guidelines, changed this. So they basically got rid of this whole category of pre-hypertension. So you either have hypertension or you don't. Normal is still less than 120 over 80, so that hasn't changed. We have this new classification, elevated, blood pressure 120 to 129, less than 80. You don't necessarily need to treat that, but it's something to be aware of for prevention. Then you have stage 1 hypertension, so that is new. So that's a blood pressure of 130 to 139 over 80 to 89. And then stage 2, similar to before, you have an elevated blood pressure greater than 140 over 90. Why did they do this? It's mainly based on this new study called the SPRINT trial. It came out in 2015 in the New England Journal of Medicine. And they basically compared two groups, so blood pressure goal less than 120 versus the standard of care at the time, which was shooting for less than 140. So you have a very intensive treatment group. It looked at over 9,300 adults aged 50 years or older, and 25% of those patients were actually older than age 75. So what did they find? Basically, the intensive group shooting for less than a blood pressure of 120 actually did better. So you reduced the risk of death by 27%, lowered the risk of heart attack, strokes, and heart failure by 25%, and even older patients greater than 75 years old actually benefited as well. But there were some adverse effects of this intensive treatment, and I can talk about that in the Q&A. Okay, I'm going to switch gears again. A bit and talk about non-pharmacological interventions, things that you can do to both prevent and treat hypertension. And then I'm also going to talk about in later slides how much that actually makes a difference. So number one, and this is coming straight from the guidelines themselves with the highest level of evidence and expert recommendation. Number one, weight loss is recommended both for prevention and treatment of hypertension. And as the previous group touched upon, a heart-healthy diet, mainly the DASH diet, is recommended as well. And that includes things like whole grains, a lot of fish, a lot of vegetables, less red meat, and saturated fats. Sodium reduction is also recommended, and we'll talk about the cutoffs for that. Potassium supplementation is also important as well, and has been proven to actually improve hypertension. Increased physical activity and exercise certainly helps. That's been shown in multiple studies. And then lastly, alcohol restriction. So the general recommendation is less than 2 drinks per day for men or less than 1 drink per day for women. So this being a Saturday,
bias.
Tonight you might want to think
serious
about,
bias.
Instead of going to the bar, maybe using a stationary bike and drinking an avocado smoothie or something like that. So let's go into this in a little bit more detail, and I'm going to specify how much these changes actually made a difference. So with weight loss, it boils down to, so if you're able to lose a kilogram of weight, you can drop your blood pressure by 1 point if you have hypertension. So that's pretty significant, but the average in terms of lowering your blood pressure is about 5 points. That's all. With a DASH diet, there was a good study about this. It actually has a dramatic effect. You can reduce your blood pressure by around 11 points. It's pretty significant. A lot of medications have reached that goal. In terms of sodium reduction, here it says the optimal goal is to try to shoot for less than 1,500 milligrams per day. That's really, really difficult. I generally recommend for my patients to try to cut below 3,000 milligrams or 3 grams per day. But you do have a significant decrease in blood pressure with those changes, about 5 to 6 points. Potassium, similarly, you get a 5-point drop. In terms of physical activity, any physical activity is good. Cardio exercise is probably the best, but whatever you can do consistently is great. On average, you get about a 5 to 8 point drop, as long as you're exercising anywhere from 30 to 45 minutes a day for about 4 to 5 times a week. And then, as we touched upon, alcohol restriction certainly helps. You get about a 4-point reduction with that. So if there's one take-home slide, this is it. This is the summary of the new ACC/AHA guidelines on hypertension, and I'll just break it down for you. So, with a blood pressure of less than 120 over 80, you don't need any treatment. You just have routine follow-up. With this category of elevated blood pressure, 120 to 129, less than 80, lifestyle, dietary recommendations are generally recommended for everybody. Here's where things flip. If you have a blood pressure of 130 to 139 over 80 to 89, if you don't have any risk factors for cardiac disease, if you don't have diabetes, your age is less than 65 years old. There's also this atherosclerotic disease calculator that the AHA uses. If your risk score is less than 10% for the next 10 years, then you still pursue dietary and lifestyle changes. But if you have any of those risk factors, so coronary disease, kidney disease, diabetes, age greater than 65, it's actually recommended to start medications. And then stage 2 hypertension, go straight to medical therapy. That hasn't really changed. And oftentimes these patients actually need 2 medications. Just to briefly touch upon the drugs that we use to treat hypertension, these haven't changed from previous guidelines. First-line therapy is still generally recommended. For the general population, you have your choice of 3 different drugs, thiazide diuretic, calcium channel blocker, or an ACE inhibitor, or ARB. For African-American patients, calcium channel blockers and thiazide diuretics have been proven to be more effective. And then for people with diabetes and kidney disease, ACE and ARBs are recommended. And then different drugs, beta blockers for aortic disease, and also special drugs for pregnant people. So, take home points of this slide, this whole presentation. New goal is less than 130 over 80. Diet and exercise can be quite effective, and you can get a significant drop when compared to some medications that we use. The new guidelines recommend, even for patients greater than 65, intensive management of hypertension, and that's based on the SPRINT trial. There are some controversial things about these guidelines. Not everyone has accepted them. The vast majority of cardiologists are using them. But we can talk about more of these points in the Q&A. Some of the things to point out is that patients with comorbid conditions, who are older, more frail, it's difficult to say if these guidelines apply and are as effective. And also people with low diastolic blood pressures, it's unclear what to do in that case. Then there's also this exercise-induced hypertension phenomenon, and it's also not clear based on literature and studies what to do about that situation. All right, any questions?
I got one right here.
Okay.
That was great, yeah. I mean, this really is a little bit of a quagmire, and I have a question, but I want to ask my question first, is how important is it to personalize this? Because there's such a difference between that someone who's 65, 75, 85, amount of drugs, drug side effects, how much time do you spend doing that, and do these new guidelines affect that personalization?
Yeah, great question. I think that's the art of medicine. Especially when it comes to hypertension, not everybody's the same. Not everyone's going to respond to certain medications in the same way. So side effects are huge. Even in the SPRINT trial, which was a really, really tightly controlled trial, we had well over 20% adverse effects. So things like dizziness, fainting, things like that. If you can anticipate that for certain people, I think it helps choosing the right drug. And then we want to choose dietary or exercise recommendations aggressively versus going straight to medications. But yeah, it's an individual decision ultimately. And you incorporate the comorbid conditions and you try to figure out how much side effects and how effective it will ultimately be.
And following on that theme, this is a question from Sally, who basically asks frequently if her blood pressure is higher in the office when she goes. Yeah. That would be my patients never learn that. That's okay. And then it's lower noon. How do you know what's the most accurate, and how should we base our decisions on office versus just more frequent? And if you do it at home, what's the best way of doing it?
Yeah, great question. So being in the clinic, being in the cardiologist's office is stressful. So. Experts recommend that ambulatory blood pressure monitoring and home blood pressure monitoring is probably more effective than the blood pressures we get in the clinic. And it's challenging to have everybody get these 24-hour monitors at home, but if you can, you try to do that. If you're basing your decision, both diagnosis and treatment, based on the blood pressures in the office, you want to get 3 different blood pressures on 3 different occasions over several weeks to really demonstrate a trend. So that's very important. But white coat hypertension is very, very common. And you get points roughly from 5 to 15 higher than you would get at home.
Are there some machines that are better for home hydrating than others? I mean, I always get this question. I don't have a very good answer for it. What do you recommend?
Yeah, I often, patients often ask me, like, which brand's the best, and I can't really endorse a brand, but I do know that the arm cuffs tend to be a bit more accurate in certain cases than the wrist cuffs. You also want to make sure that the cuff size is appropriate for your arm size. I think those are the two key points.
And here's a good one from John about what happens when your blood pressure is too low. Is that a risk when I'm taking too much medication and when my blood pressure is high in the office and then I go home it's low? What's the real risk factor for the risk of having too low blood pressure?
Yeah, there's certainly a risk of having too low blood pressure. You can get fainting, dizziness, confusion in extreme circumstances. So you just have to be very careful. I'd say generally if someone's blood pressure is going below 100, it's time to scale back on some of the medications. And certainly if they're having symptoms of postural dizziness and things like that, then it's time to reevaluate what they're on.
Great. So this is a question from Mara, and this is actually for the HVI staff. And it reflects the fact I was standing in the back and there were a lot of people taking pictures of your last few slides, which I love it. We are in Silicon Valley and you guys all have your phones out. And are these presentation slides, Amy, are these available on a website or something like that? Because this really says it all. It's a very nice summary. Do we have those, Amy?
We can make them available. If you want to let Donna and I know, we can put a link out there on the website for you to access these slides
I think the whole talk, because also the different factors, non-pharmacologic, that you can do to really impact numerically your blood pressure, I think are really compelling and helpful. So.
Yeah, I'd be happy to provide those slides. The key slides were taken directly from the ACC and chain guidelines. And I believe I'm on Facebook Live.
So right now he is being put on Facebook Live. So head over to Facebook too if you want to see that.
Well, that was a great summary. We now have a half an hour break, and there's a wonderful health fair out there. There are a lot of us. I want to thank Abbott and Medtronic and Boston Scientific. There's specifically brought some toys for you to play with, some devices, and we'll reconvene in half an hour.